Ryan. I'm one of the pastors here at Emergence Church, and we are glad that you are tuning in to join or check out one of our worship services. This is a service from our Thursday night service, and our hope is that it's an encouragement to your faith. We also hope if you're not plugged into a local church, that that would be a priority. Church is a huge gift from God to us, and while we can have things to resource our discipleship like online services, they're never a replacement for actually joining and committing to a local church. If you are in New Jersey, we'd love to have you come check us out one Thursday night or one Sunday morning at any of our services in any of our locations, and you can find that online. And now it is a hope that you would be blessed by this service.
Now sit high. Oh God, the battle belongs to you. And every fear I lay at your feet, I'll sing through the night. Oh God, the battle belongs to you. There's nothing shadows, you win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. Almighty fortress, you go before us. Nothing can stand against the power. To gather in your name, to worship your name and lift it high. Father, I pray tonight as we open up your word and hear from you, God, would you speak to us, draw near to us, encourage the brokenhearted. We ask for healing in Jesus' name. God, would you move in a way only you can? We love you, we worship you, and we pray all these things in Jesus' name. Say together, amen. Amen. Hey, great to see you all. Before you grab a seat, why don't you greet somebody around you? And then you can have a seat. Well, hey, everybody, how are you? It is great to be with you. And as we gather
today to celebrate Jesus, to get the chance to sing praise together. We get to worship together in a few different ways. If you're checking out Emergence tonight, well, you know, we keep it simple, and we do worship in just a few ways as we gather. We sing like we just did. We'll continue more of that later. We look at Scripture, and we worship by sitting under teaching that talks about God's Word, and His Spirit moves and teaches our hearts as we listen to it, and looking forward to that. And we also worship by being generous, and one of the things that God calls us to be is a blessing where He's placed us. And so, not just to receive His blessing, but to be a blessing together. And one of the ways we do that is by giving, and whether that's giving our time by serving, or whether that is giving our resources to help see the gospel advanced here and around the world, we get to do that. It's a privilege to do that with all of you. And so if you're checking out Emergence tonight, I want to let you know, we're not looking to get your money. We hope you have a great experience here tonight. But if you're someone who calls us your church home, you know that we don't pass a basket or a plate for an offering. We've got boxes in the back. Most of us give online, but we would love to know that you're here tonight. And so if you are visiting tonight, you got these Connect cards in the seat back in front of you. If you would take one of those, if you want to go analog, you can fill that out on there. You can also put a prayer request on the back. You can let us know if throughout the course of the night, you give your life to Jesus as well. We have that opportunity to know Him and walk with Him. And so we'd love to know that you're here. We'd love to know more about you and how we can serve you and serve your family as well as serve together. So there's that card. Drop it in a box or bring it to the Connect desk. We have a gift for you if you are brand new as well. Also tonight, we get the unique chance to worship through communion. And so as you came in, hopefully you got your elements for it. And so if you'd like to take communion tonight, make sure that you get those. We'll also give you a chance later on to grab that, but we are going to take communion later on tonight as we continue in worship. And so as we continue on, I want to let you know about stuff that's going on all around the church. There's a lot happening. Excited about some things coming up. Why don't you check out this week's news?
Hey, I'm Carly.
And I'm Andrew.
And here's everything you need to know about what's happening at Emergence.
That's right, spring is in full bloom here, and it's time for new things. Maybe for you, checking out Jesus is all brand new. And if that's the case, we have a group for you. It's called Starting Point, and it all kicks off next week on Sunday, April 21st at 10:20 in Totowa and 10:30 in Ringwood. You can sign up for it right now on the digital bulletin.
If you're looking to plug in, the best way to do that is in a community group. Community groups are small groups of people that meet in various places all around North Jersey. They meet on all different days of the week, so chances are there's one that'll work for your location and your schedule. In communities, we connect with one another, pray together, and learn to apply truths from the Bible to our lives.
The spring season of communities has just kicked off, but it's not too late to join. You can check out all of the groups that are available by using our digital bulletin or stop at the Connect desk before you leave.
We have a brand new date to mark on your calendars. If you serve on any team at Emergence, set aside May 17th for this year's Impact Celebration. We will get to share stories on how God worked this year, celebrate how God used each one of our teams, and share in some food and fun together May 17th. Circle the date today.
Can't wait. So we got one more exciting event to share with you today. If you are in middle school or high school, we have a very special guest here to share with you all about Spirit Blast.
Blue, orange, yellow, green. Who will win? Ah! Okay, that's in my eye. Guys, April 20th, right around the bend, Spirit Blast is coming up. If you're in middle or high school, we're gonna be at the Ringwood Campus Emergence. We're gonna be having a great time. There's color races, there's relay races, puzzle games, tug of war. So much fun, bring your friends out. Don't worry, parents, this gets out of your clothes, I hope. Picture Survivor meets Jesus. We'll see you there. Hey, listen, if you're on the fence, you're thinking maybe they don't need me. We need you. By the way, I'm Curtis. Nice to meet you. I'm the student director here at Emergence, and it's gonna be a great time. We hope to see you guys out there. Hey, we'll see you there. No. Don't pretend like you're not coming. You're coming. I'll see you there. All right? I will. I'll see you there.
Spirit Blast!
There you go. Middle school and high school students, don't miss it.
For more info on that or anything else going on in the church, check out this week's news on the digital bulletin. You can use the QR code in the chair right in front of you to get there.
That's right. Let's keep on loving Jesus, loving people, and plowing a counterculture.
Bye, everyone.
Bye-bye.
Spirit bless!
Oh my God.
Hey everyone, Thursday night, ready to go. If you're visiting with us, glad that you are here. Honestly, we gather on Sunday, but don't worry about it. There's no room left on Sunday. Just come on Thursday. That's the night. That's awesome. And so we're really grateful for you. Grateful for Curtis and Tyler and the team that lead in our student ministries and what's going on there as we've seen a ton of students start coming out to the ministry. Some students brand new. Some students have become Christians in this past year. And so super exciting to see even my kids bringing they're friends from high school, and it's just awesome to see how God's working in the student ministries. And so if you know someone who's on the fence and might be a great first step for them into our student ministry, that would be an awesome opportunity, spirit blast. And so we got a ton to get through tonight. John chapter 3, we saw the first half last week. Gonna wrap up John 3 this week. There's a ton of stuff in it, so no time to waste. Let's just dive right into it. It says this in John 3:22. After this, Jesus and his disciples went into the Judean countryside, and he remained there with them and was baptizing. John also was baptizing at Enir near Salim, because water was plentiful there. And people were coming and being baptized, for John had not yet been put in prison. So we pick up the text and we see Jesus and John are doing baptism ministry. John baptized people in repentance. I'm sure the baptism that Jesus was doing with his disciples looked similar to that. And this really is not a huge point in the sermon, but do want to say, in a few weeks, we're going to have our baptism service. And if you are a Christian, you should be baptized. Here's why. Jesus commanded it. In the Great Commission, he says, go make disciples of all nations and baptize them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. I have one point on why you should be baptized. Jesus commanded it. If that's not enough, I don't know what to tell you. If you need 5 points, here, there's only one. Jesus commanded it. Some people are like, you know, what will my grandma think? What will my friends think? It doesn't matter what they think. Jesus commanded it. So if you've been a Christian for 50 years and haven't been baptized, if you've been a Christian for 5 minutes and haven't been baptized, you should be baptized, okay? It's a matter of obeying Jesus. There is no next level you have to get to before you need to be baptized. If you're a Christian, Jesus says be baptized, and the way in the New Testament people often came forward and said, I'm a Christian, is they responded in baptism. And if you need more than Jesus commanded it, I can't help you because that's all I got. June 6th and 9th, favorite Sunday of the year, and some really cool stories of people coming to faith over the last several months that I'm excited about on that day, you guys getting to hear. It honestly is the best service we do all year. And so if you are someone who hasn't been baptized, you should be, okay? So as Jesus and John are baptizing in a similar area, someone comes down, looks like a religious leader, and they begin to have this discussion about baptism, which leads to some observations among John the Baptist's disciples. Look what happens. Now, a discussion arose between some of John's disciples and a Jew over purification. And they came to John, that's John the Baptist, not John the writer, and said to him, Rabbi, he who was with you across the Jordan, to whom you bore witness, look, he's baptizing, and all are going to him. And so John's baptizing, Jesus is baptizing. The discussion happens between this probably religious figure and the disciples of John. As they're talking about that, some of John's disciples begin to realize, hey, you know what? Jesus' baptism ministry is really growing. John's baptism ministry, not so much. And so they go back to John. And they're like, hey, you know, maybe it's jealousy. Maybe they're a little embarrassed for John. But they're like, hey, John, we don't quite know how to bring this up. Everyone's going over to Jesus's baptism ministry, and less people are coming to our ministry. In fact, some of the guys from our team have started to go over to Jesus' ministry. You got to see this, John. You got to do something about it. And John's going to give some awesome truth tonight as he responds to that. Here's what I want to say. If you are a Christian, you've been a Christian for some time, there will be a time in your life where you are involved in a ministry or a church or a small group or some sort of college ministry that you love. like John the Baptist's disciples, they love John the Baptist. They love that ministry. And now they're in a season where that ministry that they love so much, it's changing. And they're concerned. They're a little grieved by that, perhaps a little jealous, perhaps a little upset. And there's all kinds of ministries. There's all kinds of reasons why a ministry might change or a ministry might have a new season. One of the guys on our board who has been with Emergence from when we launched in Totowa, he's one of the elders at our church, Michael Kim, he always talks to me about, hey, you know, Charles Spurgeon at one point had the largest church in England. That church doesn't really exist anymore. What you find is in ministry, there are seasons, right? And some churches and some ministries have really, really long seasons. Some are multi-generations, and they go from generation to generation to generation, and they're bearing fruit. Some ministries have really short seasons. Some of you guys, maybe you were in an awesome 20-something ministry when you first went to college or when you got out of college, and the Word of God just came alive and the people loved each other well. And then what happened is all the leaders started to marry each other and the ministry just changed, right? Ministries have seasons. Ministries change. All types of reasons why that happens. Sometimes in a season, God uses someone powerfully, uses a group powerfully. There's an awakening to God's word powerfully, and that lasts for a season, and then it just starts to shift. Sometimes a leader fails, and the ministry falls apart. Sometimes a leader fails, and the next leader comes in, and the ministry grows like crazy. Sometimes a leader moves. Sometimes you have to move. Right? Sometimes we see in the book of Acts, persecution can break out. The church in Jerusalem's growing like crazy. Suddenly persecution breaks out and they all got to go. That'll change the ministry. Some of you guys tragically have been involved in ministries that Satan just attacked. And what started out as really beautiful became a place of gossip and division and slander, and it fell apart. Sometimes God raises up unique individuals in a season and uses them powerfully. I think we just witnessed that in New York City with Pastor Tim Keller. I think Pastor Tim Keller was a pastor of pastors, a generational pastor. There's no replacing that guy. There's like no next Tim Keller. And God does that. He raises up people. He raises up ministries. He raises up churches. And sometimes those churches have really long generational runs. Sometimes those churches or leaders have really short seasons. I can look at my own life. Some of the most influential churches from 20 years ago, 30 years ago, no longer exist or certainly no longer have the influence they once did. Tragically, sometimes it's because they've left the Word of God. They've stopped preaching the gospel. They've stopped sharing the Bible. And in those cases, I'm kind of glad the ministry declines. Because the last thing you need is people going to church but not learning about Jesus and salvation. And there's all kinds of reasons for this. But I guarantee you there's a lot of older Christians in this room that have been part of ministries that they've loved, that they've served, that they've funded, that they've built. And for a season, those ministries were super influential in their lives. And then that season passed. And if you're honest, you can get what John the Baptist disciples are going through a little bit here. There is some grieving. There can be some jealousy. There can be some frustration. There can be some turf stuff that raises up in your heart. And often, like John's disciples, it's usually the most faithful that hold on the longest, right? Like some have already gone, but these guys, the guys that are left, they really care about John and they really care about the ministry. And I'm always blown away when the faithful core, everyone's left, the faithful core is there serving faithfully. And I'm always blown away when they have the wisdom to step back and realize, you know what? This needs a new season. This needs a transition. Because these are often the people that care the most about that ministry. So a few years ago, we got to see this with our Ringwood campus, right? There were some faithful leaders over the decades that served well at Ringwood Baptist Church. Over time, things changed, and that season of ministry kind of ended, and the church got older, and many people moved on. There's a faithful handful of people. And they said, if we're honest, we're not going to revitalize this church. No one's going to come move in for us 12 older folks and uproot their family. And even if they did, I don't know if we have the capacity to really revitalize this outside a total miraculous move of God. And I think it's best if we transition this ministry. And sometimes what you have to do, it's almost like a parent who raises their daughter. They love them very much. But eventually, there's a time where you'll have to, if she gets married, walk her down the aisle and give her away. And what was amazing is a number of years ago, there were some really faithful leaders at Ringwood Baptist Church who took that church and in many ways walked her down the aisle and said, hey, we want to see this church. We want to see the gospel alive in it. We want to see young children in it. We want to see families go to it. We want to see that happen. And because of their courage and because of their humility and because of their faithfulness, we have many weeks where that church is full over multiple services and full of kids and full of life and full of the gospel and full of lives changed. That's really hard when you love a ministry. Some of you guys have walked through what John the Baptist disciples are walking through. They love that ministry and they're seeing it change. And they go to John, and they're like, John, I don't know if you're aware, Jesus' ministry is really growing. Here's what John says. John's answer is awesome. John answered, a person cannot receive one thing unless it's given him from heaven. You yourselves bear me witness that I said, I'm not the Christ, but I've been sent before him. John's like, remember, I told you guys, I'm not the guy. My job was to announce the guy. And here's one truth you can always take with you. If no one grows anything unless God gives it to them. Jesus says it like this. Unless you abide in me, you cannot bear fruit. And so we'll walk through this life. If you're a Christian, there will be pastors, there will be authors, there will be worship leaders, there will be ministries that really encourage you. And sure, thank God for them. Thank God that he uses them to encourage you. But don't stop with them, right? Go to the one who gave them, God. And let those authors or musicians or pastors or seminary professors or older saints, let them encourage you to worship the one who allowed them to serve you. Because if it wasn't for God, there is no growth. Not one thing happens unless God gives it. Because sometimes, you know what happens? You really love a church or you really love a ministry and God moves you. And you might feel like, I'll never find a church like that again. I'll never find a ministry like that again. Here's what you can always find, the God who gave that. Wherever you go at any church that's faithful to the gospel, you will find the God who gave that ministry. And he loves you, and he's faithful. And there's nothing that happens in any ministry unless God gives it. So don't stop at thanking God for the faithful people. Go to the God who gave them. Let your thanksgiving go to him. That's the first thing John says. Here's the second. He gives this great illustration. The one who has the bride is the bridegroom. The friend of the bridegroom who stands and hears him rejoices greatly at the bridegroom's voice. Therefore, this joy of mine is now complete. He must increase, but I must decrease. John gives the illustration of his ministry, and he's like, I'm like the best man at the wedding. What's the job of the best man at the wedding? Not to ruin the wedding. How do best men ruin the wedding? Well, they make it about them. Right? There's the best man who thinks he's got to be the funny best man and do something stupid in the middle of the wedding, tell a big joke, do something funny, and it's always dumb. Right? There's the best man who thinks he's a prankster and he's got to do a prank or a magic trick. He'll try to lean over and kiss the bride, and it is dumb and ruins the wedding. And guys, if you're young and you know this is true, your future wife barely likes your best man.
So, you know, she's, do not ruin her day because your best man's an idiot with like, have to be funny, have to do the prank, or just drunk best man who gets wasted and falls over and slurs the speech. All of those best mans, the reason they ruin the wedding, they make the wedding about them. Anytime people are leaving, they're talking about the best man. That was an awful best man. What people should be leaving talking about is how awesome it is that that couple's married. And John says, I'm the best man. My joy is pointing to the bridegroom. My joy is pointing to Jesus. I don't want people leaving talking about me. I want people leaving talking about Jesus. And I want to be the best man I can. And the only way I can do that is he must increase, I must decrease. He must increase, I must decrease. That is the exact opposite message of our entire culture. So I have a prop tonight. I don't know if you guys know what this is. That's just kidding, it's a cell phone. Our generation, like they put a camera in this thing. And what did our generation figure out how to do? Rather than taking a picture of anything else, we take a picture of ourselves. Like we are the selfie generation. Like every day, millions of pictures get taken. Most are selfies. There are now people who die taking selfies. There's a category of death called death by selfie. Death by selfie actually passed this year death by shark. No joke, meaning you are more likely to die taking a selfie than you are getting eaten by a shark. And I realize some of you guys are grown men and you're visiting and you're like, what's a selfie? The selfie is when you take, I'll teach you how to do it if you're a grown man. You take your phone and like you got it out and you just want to put it down a little lower, put it down a little lower and leave it right there because you're a grown man and you don't take selfies, all right? For the glory of God, that's how you take a selfie if you're a grown man. You just don't do it. And we are a generation that has been told a total lie, that you're only going to find joy and happiness and purpose and contentment by being true to you. But what's John the Baptist say? No. My joy is complete when he's first, when he's increasing. My ministry is good when he's first and he's increasing and it's not about me. My life has purpose when he's increasing. My gifts grow when he's increasing and I'm decreasing. And John says, here's what I want in ministry. I want him to increase and I want to decrease. I want it to be all about him and very little about me. And then we just see a number of reasons, I'm gonna give you five, why it's so important for Jesus to increase and for us to decrease. John just lists them, here we go. It says this awesome thing. Five reasons. You want Jesus to increase and you to decrease in life and ministry. Here's what John 3:31 says. He who comes from above is above all. He who is of the earth belongs to the earth and speaks in an earthly way. He who comes from heaven is above all. He bears witness to what he's seen and heard, yet no one receives his testimony. First reason we want Jesus to increase, because only he came from heaven. We came from earth. We have totally different starting places. My starting place, January 21st, 1978. Jesus' starting place, eternity past. Some of you guys are pretty smart and pretty talented. You're like, I built an app. Jesus made the universe. Like he spoke it into existence. You're like, I went to Yale. He went to heaven. It's better. It's better. You want him to increase, you to decrease. Second thing, whoever receives his testimony sets a seal to this, that God is true. For he whom God has sent utters the words of God. Really important. Jesus must increase because only Jesus speaks the words of God. Right? Only Jesus speaks the words of God. We as a church preach God's word. It's why we go through books of the Bible, right? It's why the sermon series isn't called Next Level. 2024, go to your next level. I don't even know if there's any verses in the Bible about going to your next level. There's a whole lot of sermons about it, right? But we want to talk about actually Jesus increasing. And so we teach through the Bible. But even though we teach through the Bible, we still have to study it. We still have to interpret it, try to do our best with it, to proclaim it. There's times where I try to communicate things and it comes out all wrong. There's times I wish I was clearer. There's times I wish I said it better. There's times where it comes out and I'm like, oh, that got jumbled up. Whenever Jesus speaks, he utters the very words of God the Father. There is no speculation. There is no interpretation. There's only revelation. There's only God's word and God's truth. And when we do what he proclaims, we declare what God proclaims true. He must increase. Here's the third. For he gives the Spirit without measure. Okay, third thing. Only Jesus can fully give the Spirit of God. So in the Old Testament, there are times where God uses people and they'd go and they'd preach or they'd lead and the Spirit might come down and come upon them for a season or come upon them for a task or come upon them for a purpose or come around them. But in the New Testament, what we find is Jesus actually sends the Spirit to come in and to indwell us. One of my favorite parts about preaching every week is that I have to pray, God, please let your Spirit work. Like, I can teach your word and I can proclaim the truth of the Bible, but we need your Holy Spirit to encourage people who need encouragement, to rebuke people who need rebuke, to correct things they believe that are wrong, to bind people up, to show them your love and mercy. And only God's Spirit can do that. And I'll tell you, one of the most amazing things about teaching the Bible is you teach the Bible and you see God's Holy Spirit can go and correct someone over here and go and comfort someone over here. God's Holy Spirit can rebuke this person and build up this person the same word. You know why? Because God's Holy Spirit goes to work. But Jesus actually sends the Spirit. Jesus actually gives the Spirit without measure. He gives it fully and completely. And he alone can do that. He must increase. We must decrease. We don't do that. Here's the fourth. The Father loves the Son and has given all things into his hand. Here's the fourth. Only Jesus has authority over all things. Meaning, my life. I love how Paul says it. All things exist by him and for him. Everything on this earth exist by him, because he's the creator, and for him. This is why the greatest thing you can give someone is not your life, though you can love people and serve them, but the greatest thing you can give them is Jesus. Because their lives don't exist by you and for you. Their lives exist by him and for him. And so the greatest thing you can give to someone is Jesus. And all authority, only all authority and power belongs to him. Here's the fifth one. And this one's the doozy we're going to spend some time on. Whoever believes in the Son has eternal life. Whoever does not obey the Son shall not see life, but the wrath of God remains on him. Here's the last one. Only Jesus can give you eternal life and save you from the wrath of God. Only Jesus can give you eternal life and save you from the wrath of God. And I love that John in this passage puts together, he almost makes them like a proverb where he lines them up as equal, believing in Jesus and obeying Jesus. For John, there's not a lot of distance between that. He says, for some, they will believe that Jesus came and Jesus went to a cross and Jesus died for their sins and they will have eternal life. For some, they will not obey the Son. They won't believe. And for those who don't believe and remain in their sins, here's what this text teaches. The wrath of God remains on him. meaning unless you've grabbed hold of God's eternal life, God's wrath remains on you. Now, I know we probably don't hear a lot about God's wrath in our culture. If you read the Bible, you do see a lot about the wrath of God. We see over 600 times in the scriptures the Bible refer to the wrath of God in this situation. God's wrath, God has wrath towards sin and sinners. It's passionate displeasure. The image is like a flaring of the nostrils. That's the wrath of God. And God's wrath is directed at both sin and sinners. We see flashes of it at times throughout the scripture. Right? We see flashes of his wrath in Noah in the destruction of the earth. We see times where God opens the earth and swallows those in rebellion. We see flashes of his wrath in judgment. In the New Testament, we see the people in 1 Corinthians are abusing communion and they're dying during communion. We see flashes of God's wrath in the New Testament with Ananias and Sapphira when they come to the leaders and they lie and they're struck down dead. We see these images of judgment, of exile, of loss of war, these moments of God's wrath. But ultimately, in the Bible, the climax of the wrath of God is God's ultimate judgment in hell. The eternal judgment that God makes where his wrath is perfectly poured out in hell. And this is where some people are like, see, this is why I don't like to talk about the Old Testament. I like Jesus. Well, just a heads up, no one in the Bible talks more about hell than Jesus. Jesus, throughout his ministry, is constantly warning about hell, constantly pointing to the horror and the reality of hell. In fact, in one of his teachings, he says, it's better to gouge out your own eye or cut off your own arm than go to hell. Meaning the wrath of God is so severe that you would be better off maiming yourself in this life to ensure that you don't remain, like John says, under the wrath of God and headed for hell. It says you want to do all you can to make sure that does not happen. We get a horrendous picture of this in Revelation chapter 14 as the same author, John, who writes this gospel, writes the book of Revelation as he describes the wrath of God in Revelation 14. This is what he says. He also will drink the wine of God's wrath, poured full strength into the cup of his anger, and he will be tormented with fire and sulfur in the presence of the holy angels and in the presence of the Lamb. And the smoke of their torment goes up forever and ever, and they have no rest day and night. This image of the cup of God's wrath is something we see throughout the scriptures as God's wrath builds up in this cup until he's perfectly pours it out in judgment. That, and this is what John's saying, if we have not believed in Jesus Christ, we're still under that wrath. And the decisions we make of rebellion towards God or disobedience towards God or hatred towards God, even the fact that we might hate this right now, what it is it's filling up that cup, that wrath is stored up for a judgment. And people believe all kinds of crazy lies about hell that aren't in the Bible. Some people have this crazy notion that hell's where kind of Satan rules. And, you know, some people think it's like the party with the bad people. Notice this text does not say this is where Satan rules. This is where Satan is judged, where Satan, demons, and sinners are judged in the presence of the Lamb and his holy angels. Hell is the place of judgment where God rules. There is no place Satan rules. Some people believe, well, maybe, you know, the Bible just kind of mentions suffering, but that's just kind of a way of getting our heads to think it's bad. Look at the language of the text. It says, they burn in torment, eternal torment with fire and sulfur. In fact, later in this passage, Jesus gives two illustrations in Revelation 14 about these two pictures about the reality of this. And one is eventually there's a harvest, and the point is just this: it will happen. The harvest will happen. And the second point he makes is it will be like the treading of the winepress of God's wrath. And the image is in Revelation 14, in that culture, when they take the grapes, they put them in a wine press. And in our culture, a lot of times they have like a hand ratchet where they kind of ratchet down the stone and it slowly smushes the grape juice out. But in that time, what the laborers would do is they'd stand in the wine vat and they'd tamp down the stone. And what it says in Revelation 14 is that God will gather those in rebellion and place them in the winepress of his wrath, and he will tamp down his stone in his perfect wrath. And just as the juice would flow out of the bottom of the barrel, it says the blood will flow out, and this will be a perfect judgment to the edges of the earth. God will not miss anyone. It will be a perfect judgment for those who remain under God's wrath. There's a real physical suffering. Some people say, well, maybe after a while, the suffering just kind of ends. But do you see the language of the text? It is eternal suffering that goes up where there is no end. Sometimes people's response to something like these hard truths, because I do believe there are times to hear hard truths to make sure we don't have a hard heart. Right? If all we ever hear are soft things and have a soft view of God, we end up with a hard heart towards God. But if we allow God's word to show us the hard things, it can produce in us a right softness towards the things that are holy and matter. And sometimes people, when you talk about things like the wrath of God, will say something along the lines of, well, you're just trying to scare me. I'm not trying to scare you. But if you're under the wrath of God, you should be scared for yourself. Right? The truth is, John says, if you have not been reconciled to God through Christ, God's wrath remains on you, and hell is your future. And I wrote that this week with no joy in my heart and tears on my face. That is a heartbreaking thing that some people choose to remain under the wrath of God. I heard a guy say recently, how could a loving God judge anyone? It's so funny because we live in like the most judgmental culture in history. Like just go on Twitter, everyone judges everyone. Everyone's like, that guy should go there, you know? So God can make a judgment. You know, sometimes it's amazing. Like people are like, how could God send anyone to hell? And I'm like, I don't struggle with that question. I struggle with, how could God save anyone? I mean, God makes us and he loves us. And what do we all do in nature and choice? Rebel against him. From Genesis 3, we turn our backs. We choose, I want to do this my way. I want to be my own God. I want to find my own good and evil. And then we blame God and we blame each other when we go through the consequences of sin. I've sinned. I've rebelled against God. Now my life stinks. It's your fault, God, or it's their fault. Or we hide, or we blame. And yet, what's God do in Genesis 3? He doesn't come and just, that's it, right? No, he promises a Savior. And then he patiently waits. And throughout the Old Testament, we just see sin grow. Education doesn't stop it. Cultural advances don't stop it. Perfect, great families don't stop. Even God's judgment on Noah, right? Wipes out the earth, going to start with one righteous family. He gets off the boat, gets drunk, and ends up in sexual sin. You're like, that did, like even the good people. David, the man after God's own heart. He ends up doing what? Committing adultery and killing someone. Like everyone at every turn, we sin, we lie, we cheat, we rape, we slander. We gossip, we murder one another's reputations online. We just constantly, and then we find God a burden. We find his worship a burden. We find his service a burden. And God just patiently waits and provides his son. And even when his son comes to earth, we kill him. We crucify him. Here is the son of infinite worth, infinite beauty, whose life is far more valuable, eternal God, second member of the Trinity, and he dies. Some people go, how could one man atone for all men? Because that one man's life is worth more than creation, is more beautiful than the cosmos, is more valuable than anything that's ever existed. That one man's life is more powerful and awesome for all eternity, and only he can make an offering that has the weight and worth to save people from their sins. That's how he's able to do it. In fact, when Jesus is about to go to the cross, remember, as he's praying in the garden, sweating drops of blood, what's his concern? It's not the whip. It's not the nails in his hands and feet. It's not the suffocation. What's he pray? Look at the text in Matthew. Then he said to them, my soul is very sorrowful, even to death. Remain here and watch me. And going a little farther, he fell on his face and prayed, saying, my Father, if it's possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not as I will, but as you will. Right? God, if there's any other way for people to be saved from hell other than me drinking the cup of your wrath, let it pass. Is there any other way? And yet, since there is no other way, not my will, but your will, let salvation come. And Isaiah says, it was the will of the Lord to crush him, to pour out the cup of God's wrath that we should drink, and Jesus drinks it in our place. God has a cup of wrath for every person, and either we'll drink it, we'll face the fury of God's wrath, or Jesus, the one whose life is of infinite value and worth, will drink it in our place. Be like last week, we had the earthquake, the 4.8, and we heard it. But imagine it wasn't a 4.8. Imagine it was a 9.8. And it just ripped through and it caused a massive tsunami. And that tsunami, you could see, was 100 feet high and it was headed at you 500 miles per hour. It was crushing everything in its sight, just mowing it down. And you're seeing that tsunami coming right at you and you're going, I'm done. Like, this thing is mowing right through everything in its path. It's heading right forward towards me. And at the last possible moment, right when you were like, the earth opened up right in front of you and swallowed every last drop of the tsunami. What Jesus did on the cross when he said, it is finished, is he took the full cup of the wrath of God and drank down every drop for his beloved people in their place. Only Jesus can do that for you. And every one of us, either Jesus will drink the cup of God's wrath or we will. He's an awesome Savior. What's amazing is when he drinks the cup of God's wrath in our place, now we receive the cup of fellowship. Now we remember in communion Christ's body broken for us, Christ's blood spilled for us, that Christ, the one of infinite beauty and worth and value, swallowed God's wrath for us. Now the cup we drink is one of fellowship and remembrance and joy and love. And if you're a Christian, in a few minutes we're going to take communion. I pray you would rejoice that you have the cup of fellowship. The cup of Christ's broken body and shed blood because he was crushed. He drank the cup of wrath for you so that we could have the cup of fellowship and know his salvation. tonight, if you're not a Christian, you have to understand how important it is that you be reconciled to God. My prayer is even tonight, you would for the first time say, Jesus, thank you that you took the penalty for my sin, that for my sake you became sin so that I could become the righteousness of God. So rather tonight than having to fear the cup of wrath, I can take the cup of fellowship. And tonight, if you become a Christian, we're going to take communion in a few minutes. Communion is something for Christians. But if tonight you become a Christian, I want to encourage you to take communion with us. Rejoice that you're taking the cup of fellowship, that Christ died for you, that Christ took your sin, that Christ rose, and Christ can make you new. Let me pray for us, and we'll worship the God who's worth worship together. God, we thank you that this beautiful truth is real, that you must increase, that we must decrease. And Lord, I pray for those tonight who for the first time would say, God, would you increase in my life? God, would you forgive my sins? God, thank you so much that you loved me in spite of the fact that I wanted nothing to do with you so much that you allowed your son who you loved to go to a cross and to drink down the judgment that I deserved, to take the wrath that was right towards me in my place. And thank you that you died and rose and conquered death. You took my sin. Thank you that you drank the cup so I don't have to. And now, Lord, I want to walk in thanksgiving and fellowship with you to rejoice that you shed your blood for me. And now I have a cup of friendship with you. Thank you for your grace. Help me to live for you. Thank you that I can believe in you and, like John says, receive eternal life. Help me to obey you more and more. Thank you for your amazing love. In Jesus' name, amen.
Hallelujah, hallelujah. If you love the Lord and he saved you the way he did me, then if you can rise with me and sing, worship the Lord, hallelujah. Father, we worship you. We praise your name, living God, for your goodness, hallelujah. There's no one like you, none beside. I was lost, I was blind, I was running out of time. Sin separated, the bridge was far too wide. But from the far side of the chasm, you held me in your sight. So you made a way across a great divide. Left behind heaven's throne to build it here inside. And there at the cross, you paid the debt I owed. Broke my chains, freed my soul. For the first time I had hope. Thank you, Jesus, for the blood.
Together. If you didn't receive the elements as you came in, if you'll raise your hand up high, our ushers are making their way around to make sure that everyone received the elements. But as we prepare our hearts to receive, I wanted to share a couple passages of scripture. First of all, in Romans chapter 5, starting in verse 8, it says, But God shows his love for us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Since therefore we have now been justified by his blood, much more shall we be saved by him from the wrath of God. It's only through the blood of Jesus, his body that was broken for us, his blood that was shed on our behalf, that we can have new hope, that we can have new life, that we can be saved from the wrath of God. And Jesus gives us instructions. We read in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, it says, the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took the bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, this is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me. So let's take the bread together and remember the sacrifice of our Lord. In the same way also, he took the cup after supper, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink of it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat of this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Let's take the cup together. And Father, we do thank you. God, we thank you for the blood that Jesus shed on our behalf. God, we thank you for his body that was broken for us, God, that you demonstrated your love for us. And that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us, God. God, I pray that as we receive those elements together and we remember the sacrifice that was made on our behalf, God. I pray that by the power of your Spirit, God, you would help us to live for you, God. That we would live in a manner worthy of the sacrifice that Jesus made for us, God. Father, we thank you. Thank you for the blood.
Buried for 3 days, but then you walked right out again. Thank you.
before we pray, just want to let you know we have a prayer team that would love to pray for you over there against the wall. And if they're with whatever's going on in your life, and they're happy to pray for you. And so, but just do want to say if you are just feel like I want to make sure that I have put my faith in the one who saves. Make sure to pray with them. They would help you with that and can give clarity where you need it. And I'll pray for us before we go. God, thank you that you're good and that you're kind, and yet you're also holy, and you don't fly off the handle like an abusive father and just strike us all with lightning. But you do have a patient wrath that's appeased through your Son. Thank you that you made a way for us to be rescued in spite of us. And so, God, would we rejoice at the great love you have for us? And then, God, would you help us to be people who say, help us to decrease and you to increase in our lives, in our witness, as we love others, as we love our families. Let them see more of you. We ask it all for your glory, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Have a great week, everyone.